So without further ado, I hope everyone got a chance to hear John this morning, and if not, here he is, and get another chance.
It's on silence. I won't get that experience. You can talk to me afterwards if you want to know about the ringtone. I have to confess, I had to go back to the hotel and check out, and after walking outside, I almost didn't come back into the session. I thought you guys could maybe just run through the slides on your own while I basked in the sun. It was wonderful. So again, if you were at the plenary, a little bit of this is going to be review. I didn't bother with the slides because I feel like when I have a short presentation, the slides make me take too long. And so now you'll get the slides in all their glory. But I'm going to start with the same question that I did at the plenary session, which is about smartphones. So maybe we'll flip the question, though, for the folks who were there before. So who doesn't have a smartphone? And this is not meant to embarrass you or anything, but just to get a sense. So most folks have a smartphone, right? And then how many folks, of those who do have a smartphone that didn't just raise your hands, how many of you got it from the landline phone company? One, two, okay, there's a couple of folks, but not very many. And the reason that I always like to start with this question is to highlight that when innovation happens in businesses that have been traditionally organized as monopolies, it usually comes from the outside. That's usually where we're gonna see these kinds of disruptions and changes. And the same kind of thing is happening in the utility sector right now. You know, I spend most of my time, you know, I've been called the guru of distributed energy. That really means electricity. The electricity sector is going through some remarkable changes right now. And smartphones, I think the smartphone and the telecommunications analogy really holds up very well in terms of the kind of disruption that we're seeing in the electric business in terms of the changes that we're seeing happen. So, I guess I'm gonna have to go without slides, but that's fine, I did it this morning too. What we have really from, in terms of that comparison between telecommunications and the electric utility, that is what I like to call a similar monopoly problem, or in this case, apparently a resolution problem. I don't know if anybody's still in here who can zoom that out or just move the table back or forward or whatever would work. We'll see how this goes. So I wanna cover a little bit in terms of background of what's been happening with the utility business over time that has caused for this tension and this disruption that's happening with new technology. So what we have here is the start of a timeline which covers about 70 years. And what you have on the right is the primary form of power generation they had, which is large-scale centralized power generation. As I mentioned this morning, it was mostly from burning things to heat water, to make steam, to turn turbines. Or in the places with the lucky geography, we would use falling water to turn turbines for hydropower. And that went on for a good 70 years without interruption, where electricity demand was growing incredibly fast and faster with every decade. Prices were falling because they were learning to build new power plants at larger scale and generate cheaper electricity. And so it was sort of the golden age for the electricity industry. Well, there was a thing that happened in the 70s, and it wasn't just disco, it was the energy crisis. And it started to change the way that the electricity system was operating. The two lines there on the sort of chart that underlies this timeline are, in orange, the per capita electricity use, which started to level off for the first time in the history of the electricity sector. And the second one is that the price started to rise. And that, those two were sort of related, because what you had in some cases were very large power plants that went over budget for power that was no longer needed. Or was more than was needed. There was another period of stability in the 80s where that sort of turned around, power prices started to decline, but then in the 1990s there was sort of a second shock to the system, which was the advent of renewable energy, largely through state-based renewable energy standards, requiring utilities to make those investments, but also deregulation where there was a transformation in many states, now about 15 to 20 states, that have maintained deregulation where there was a separation between the owners of the power plants and the companies that sold the power to the ultimate consumer. And of course you had the beginning of renewables, but now we're in what I like to call the transformative time. And you can see it's very different from prior eras. If you look at that orange line again, per capita electricity use has now leveled off and is even declining. And so utilities are not planning for load growth anymore. They're planning for how do we make this system more efficient? How do we manage the growing gap between our peak energy demand and that average energy sales. Prices have started to rise again, but you also have enormous growth in both the deployment of renewable energy, but also, interestingly enough, in utility spending on the high voltage transmission system, which is in some ways paradoxical given that it tends to support the kind of centralized generation that was popular in the earlier eras. So what I like to say is that the utility business is no piece of cake. And this gets back to the analogy that I was making earlier today about the baker. If you were trying to improve upon a cake recipe, you probably do that through iteration and trying. One of the challenges that a monopoly utility has is that they don't, especially today when we have flat load growth, they're not building power plants all the time anymore. In fact, they're spacing them apart. It's hard to learn a lot from that. If you were going to only try your recipe every 5 to 10 years, it would take an awfully long time to make a really good cake. And the same kind of problem happens in the utility industry when we have centralized power generation, when we do it at large scale. It takes a lot of time to innovate. And unfortunately, the pressures that are being faced by electric utility companies are ones where there is rapid iteration. So for example, in 2016, we're seeing solar installations in the United States on average every 60 seconds. So I don't know how long I've been going so far, but we've probably had 3 or 4 of them since I began this presentation already. And so the iteration is remarkable, not only in terms of the mass production of the panels, which are the same whether or not you do a utility scale array or putting them on the rooftop of a building, but also in the installation process. In both cases, the cost is coming down remarkably, as much as 80% in the past 6 years. We're having unprecedented control at the local level. So, you know, I can take the phone that I've got right here. It's ringtone, you will not be privileged to hear. I apologize. But I can, with a couple taps of my fingers, turn up the temperature in my house back in Minneapolis to 80 degrees. And while it would be very surprising for my wife and children, it represents a remarkable level of control that we have on a distributed level over our energy use. And what's also amazing about it is that both of the devices that are up there can be updated and have software updates pushed out to change the way that they're able to control those systems. So again, iteration is possible at a very rapid pace. And that also is true of batteries and battery storage. And it's kind of the new and cool thing to talk about in the electricity system. Right now, batteries aren't particularly useful for doing a whole lot on a large scale, except for where the markets are set up to allow them to sell in something I'll talk about more later. But we're seeing them in electric vehicles and consumer electronics and smartwatches and whatnot. And the prices are going to come down very rapidly as a result of that mass production and deployment and use. So, interestingly, all of that is happening. We see investment, you know, well, I mentioned earlier this remarkable increase in investment in the transmission system, and yet we see a lagging investment in the distribution system and the power grid, the lower voltage system that serves the homes and the buildings and the businesses, which is really where all of the innovation and ferment is happening. And so we do have this unfortunate disconnect between the kind of slow pace of iteration that has traditionally gone in the utility sector, where they're putting their investments in terms of their capital dollars, and where we're going to see the need for that investment as the innovation hits the distribution level. So as I put up on my slide earlier, utilities are really in a whole new world at this point in terms of managing a system that has been very consistent and very stable and not subject to a lot of change. I actually did a talk in Tucson, Arizona a couple of years ago, and one of the utilities, or the local electric utility there, had a representative at my talk where I was talking about renewable energy and the opportunities for solar and whatnot. And you know, he was given the floor to kind of respond to it, and he said a few things which were interesting about the cost of solar. And then he basically said, you know, we are a conservative entity. I come to work every day to do the same thing that I did yesterday. And that is simply not the way that the electricity sector is going to operate in the future, and utilities are going to have to be prepared for that. And unfortunately, a culture of monopoly, you know, separate from sort of the political sense of the organization or the business organization, just the culture of monopoly, that you can simply come to work to do the same thing you did yesterday, is not going to be compatible with the kind of innovation and entrepreneurship that's happening. So here's a few examples of that. You know, I mentioned that I would get back to the battery storage. So Minster, Ohio, population 2,800, has its own municipal utility. They decided they wanted to make an investment in solar. I'll confess that is not a picture of the Minster, Ohio solar array. I can't remember. It's somewhere in Ohio, but it wasn't. I couldn't find a picture of Minster. But at any rate, what their goal had been to increase the amount of renewables on their local distribution system, to have, you know, long-range, predictable cost electricity, and they were going to make some money also at Ohio market. Well, the legislature changed the way that the revenue was going to be generated for that, lowered the amount of revenue that the city was going to be able to get, but they were able to work with a developer to add battery storage to the solar array. And the way that it was going to make revenue for them and work out was that they are going to be able to sell the services of that battery to the electric grid. So in the PJM market, which extends all the way from Ohio out here toward the East Coast, although more sort of in the Mid-Atlantic states, you're able to sell the services of your battery. You're able to help support the grid. The grid doesn't just need the amount of power going in to equal the amount of power going out. There are also things like maintaining a consistent voltage, making sure that the frequency is a consistent 60 hertz so that our electric motors and whatnot operate appropriately. Batteries are really good for providing that service. They can do it in an instant, much better than traditional power generation resources. And so batteries can be used in that way to help support the electric grid, but it's a perfect illustration of how there could be bottom-up. You know, a city, a municipal utility can spend its own capital at the local level and support the region-wide grid. Hawaii is another perfect illustration. You know, 15% of households have, and I think it's actually more like 20% now, the number is a little bit old, have installed solar on the rooftop simply because it was cheaper for them to get electricity from their own rooftop than from the incumbent utility. You know, it's a unique circumstance in that the utility there is importing oil for most of its electricity generation, which is particularly expensive and was particularly expensive in the past few years, although of course that's changed a little bit recently. For the first time in the history of the electric grid, these individuals and businesses were able to look to their own rooftop as a source for their electricity supply and to do it less expensively than they could from the utility. And another example that is, you know, in what's happening in places like Hawaii is that regulators are looking, okay, well, how do we make sure that more of that solar gets used on site? So how do we combine different tools? The Rocky Mountain Institute has done a number of remarkable studies on this and said that, you know, if you combine an electric vehicle with smart thermostats and some energy storage, you can use the vast majority of the solar that comes off that rooftop within the building. What's also interesting is that in their exploration of what they call grid defection, in the next 10 to 20 years, they see in almost every jurisdiction across the country, solar plus energy storage on a residential building being less expensive than electricity from the incumbent electric utility. And there's a number of assumptions that go into that about, you know, the continued escalation of cost of electricity from incumbent utilities and so forth. But what's really, I think, important about that is that, you know, utilities, when they build a new power plant, plan it for 40 to 50 year life. 10 to 20 years is half that life, and all of a sudden their power plant is going to be obsolete in terms of the price that it was anticipated to sell electricity for. So again, the ferment that is happening at the bottom, from the bottom up, is fundamentally changing how the system works. And I gave this analogy this morning. It's, you know, it's sort of like you take something that has been incredibly reliable and incredibly unchanging, and something totally unexpected is happening with it from the utility perspective. And the question is, you know, how are we going to adapt to that? I do want to talk a little bit more about how much more it can change. So Mark Jacobson at Stanford has done some really terrific studies about the shift to 100% renewable energy, both from, you know, motivated by for climate reasons, but also, of course, because of the increasingly inexpensive opportunity from renewables. Now, this is economy-wide renewable energy and not just electricity, but I think it can be kind of illustrative. So the big picture here is, you know, not to drill down too far into the nitty-gritty details, but simply that we are replacing fossil fuel and nuclear power production with wind, water, and solar. I did want to highlight very quickly, though, he has a very small amount that he thinks will come from rooftop solar. I think that underestimates how much we are likely to get from that, simply because individuals are going to be motivated economically to do that themselves. But of course, getting to that 100% renewable is going to require doing things a little differently, changing direction. One of the pieces of that is going to be to electrify everything. That if we are going to get to 100% renewable, electricity is the place where we have the greatest prospects for providing renewable energy, and we're going to have to move to electricity. We're going to have to substantially reduce our energy use by about 40% from business as usual. And then what we're going to have to do is, starting in 2020, we can't build a new fossil fuel power plant, because if we do, by the time we get to 2050, we'll be having to shut those off before their useful economic life. And this is one of the illustrations from the study that Jacobson did, and I think is particularly interesting in terms of the full scope of the kind of changes that we would need. So this is, I can't quite see the title very well here, but it's sort of an electrification timeline by 2040. So what would have to happen in terms of the things that need to be electrified in order for us to do 100% renewables, largely based on the electricity system. So you see in the near term, a lot of things in buildings would have to be electrified very soon. And then you get into all sorts of different pieces of transportation, from shipping to trucking to light duty vehicles, and then even to aircraft. And he talks about, not that we are going to have batteries providing the motive power for airplanes, but that we may have to use electricity to create the hydrogen that we would use as the fuel for aircraft. That ultimately electrification is the way that we're going to get here. So all of this change, not only all of the technology that I was mentioning beforehand, but this notion of having to reach 100% renewable energy has led a lot of people to ask the question, are utilities at this point where they have to essentially adapt or die? That can they change quickly enough? Will they change quickly enough? Or is the best way to move forward thinking about a totally different structure for how we provide our electricity services? And I think right now what's interesting is that we're sort of at this point where it looks like we have two divergent tracks, but we don't really know what the future might look like. And when we change our perspective just a little bit, and it's sort of hard to see, I apologize, this is what happens when you're getting clip art at 11 p.m. the night before your presentation, but one of those tracks has a dead end. And the point there is that using the same utility structure that we've always used is not likely to be what makes sense for when we have an incredibly distributed and dispersed and decentralized system of technology and individuals and businesses that want more control over their energy system. You certainly could. You could go down the path. There are, for example, electric utilities in Arizona that have successfully lobbied the Utilities Commission to own rooftop solar on residential property. They want to offer their own residential solar program. But that kind of centralized control of the system is going to inhibit the kinds of innovation that we might be able to see, whether that's community-based solar arrays or many other things. And they're also lobbying at the same time to that same commission to increase the cost for individuals to go solar on their home. So the problem, of course, is that our utilities not only have a lot of economic power and control over the grid system, they end up having a lot of political power. There's actually been quite a few. Arizona is a fascinating place if you want to get into the way that the politics of utilities work, but I'm sure you may have some own examples from your own places. So I want to talk about three sets of kind of new rules for the utility system. I could go on for a very long time about these, but I think what I frankly enjoy a lot more is stopping the presentation and taking questions about kind of the transformations that are happening. But I have sort of three sets of rules that I think are illustrative of the kind of changes that we're going to need to see. So one of them is just about enabling alternatives. This graphic is taken from a report that we recently published on microgrids specifically. But it's a question of how do we change the rules of the utility system to enable things to happen differently. And microgrids are a great illustration of this. There's a lot of different kinds of them. They actually sort of defy definition. The simplest one is to say it's a smaller section of the grid that can run independently. But of course, you could have that happen within a single building, but you could have it happen with a group of buildings on a campus, or you could have it happen with a group of unrelated users that are using public right-of-way to interconnect one another. But once you get to that level, that's where the rules may have to change, because in many places, utilities have a monopoly over the distribution system, or they have a franchise right to use the public right-of-way, or you have utilities that have control over interconnection laws. There are all of these different pieces that come together in terms of development of microgrids that are also parts of the larger question about how we would do decentralized renewable energy. So a second piece of it is I don't like using the term markets, because market implies, I think, for a lot of people that there aren't rules and control over the system. What we need to go from is a well-regulated monopoly to a well-regulated market. And it's, like I said in the plenary session, New York is looking at this whole process right now, and it's sort of like changing the wings on the airplane while it's in flight and hoping it doesn't crash. You can't fundamentally screw up the system enough that people will not have electricity. It's a fundamental need in your economy. And yet they know that in the way that the system has been structured is not compatible with the way that we want to do this in the future. And so what they're looking toward is how do you have some sort of independent entity that sits at the center of that grid that makes sure that the voltage is steady, that the frequency is steady, that the electricity supplied is equal to the electricity demanded, but how do you give them a set of rules to follow that are different, that don't say you're going to make a 15-year integrated resource plan and tell us where all the power is coming from in 15 years, but you're going to figure out how to make the grid system the platform that everybody else can use. Some people like the analogy of the interstate highway system, that, you know, it's publicly owned, it's public domain, and all of the different elements of our economy can share that system. So FedEx and UPS and the Postal Service can all use that system without discrimination in order to deliver services on that system. And that may be the way that we want to try to set up, and that probably is the way that we want to set up our electric system. And the other one is to allow power sharing. So I mentioned this before as well. You know, this is a graphic taken from a Sunshot report focusing on community-based solar. But the notion here, of course, is how do you share electricity from a facility that's not on your own property? That runs afoul of most of the rules that we've had for a very long time in the electricity business. And there are only about 16 states that have some form of what I like to call virtual net metering, which allow for this kind of practice to take place. But there's another meaning of the word power that's important here too, which is how do all of those individuals or businesses that are taking place in that sharing of electricity have some decision-making authority over the grid system? How can they have a role in telling and structuring the rules of that system that allow this to happen? How can they also have a role in setting up the rules for the next iteration of the system that may allow them to transact with one another? You know, a great example of this is in terms of demand response. So we've gotten to a point where a lot of utilities are now looking at essentially paying people not to use power during peak times rather than building new power plants to meet that peak demand. And the question is, and the thing that we know about that is that we are only scratching the surface of what we could possibly do with that. We've almost always only used commercial and industrial customers. There are very limited use of this with residential customers. But there's a huge opportunity there because we have customers generally, a lot of their electric load is tied up into a few very big appliances, such as washers, dryers, refrigerators, and whatnot. And most of our electric customers now probably have some sort of internet access in their home. And so it would be possible to have them turn them off for 10 minutes or 15 minutes on intervals, similar to what has been done with air conditioning load already with residential properties, and save a lot of energy in a way that we haven't been able to do before. That we could aggregate, you know, whole neighborhoods and have them be bidding into a market for this, that we could have a number of different ways of organizing it, but that we should be allowing for those kinds of things to happen and that kind of experimentation to happen. So I'm going to leave it there because I always enjoyed answering questions more than pontificating. If you want to read more about this, we have a report we published last year called Going Beyond Utility 2.0 to Energy Democracy that talks about kind of the rules and the structure of the system. I spent a whole bunch of time talking about this on a blog on our website at ilsr.org. You can follow me on Twitter if you're a tweeter. I know there are a number of people that must be for those questions who have come in earlier, but I welcome your questions. Thank you.
All the big players, Koch brothers, whoever you want to name. So how do we, though, and then this is happening all across the country, actually, so how do we effectively fight against these kinds of major policy changes that do not move us forward towards an energy democracy? I mean, so there's the little local actions, and then there's, you know, the big picture.
I think that's a great question about how we can fight back against what's happening. First of all, I'd say it is the battles that are happening around net metering are the perfect illustration of the political problem that we've created with monopoly utility companies. And frankly, I think that's always a good place to try to start the conversation or to insert into the conversation is, why is this utility company the one that is allowed to make these decisions? Like, why do we still have a monopoly? To step that conversation back as far as possible to put it in the context of that situation. So that's always helpful when you can do that. I think a second thing that I think is important in terms of that conversation and the framing for it is, if you're going to change net metering, let's at least have some proof there's a reason to do it. Because unfortunately what's happened in most places is that the utility simply says, this is a problem. And they don't have a little spreadsheet that they give you that says why it's a problem. They just say it's a problem. And they make up a really big number, like a bajillion dollars is being something, whatever. And so making sure that there's an objective and reasonable approach to that. You know, we got very lucky in Minnesota that when we passed our solar energy standard, we also created a value of solar formula. It's ironic, we don't actually use it for anything, but the utility is required to calculate what the value of solar is every year for that formula, should they ever decide to use it in place of net metering. And to date, because we made sure that there were good, all of the appropriate components were included, it's been a fairly good price, like 12 to 13 cents a kilowatt hour. It would probably be higher if we use the same formula here, simply because our fuel costs in the Midwest are lower for some of the stuff that we're offsetting. But So making sure that we have that objective piece. Now that doesn't necessarily answer your question about how do you fight that, because the rhetoric is one thing and the winning is another thing. I think a great illustration of this is a group called the Community Power Network that's based in Washington, D.C., has done a lot of solar buying cooperatives across the mid-Atlantic states. What they're doing is helping people go solar individually, but also activating them and letting them know, like, this isn't a guarantee. That you are able to do this now, and we are able to help you buy down the cost by group bidding as a group to do solar on your rooftop, but you need to participate in the political process and make sure that you are helping us send in comments to the Public Service Commission, coming to the legislature and testifying about what a benefit this has been for you and why it's important that other customers should be given this benefit as well. So it really does come down to politics and organizing. Another piece of that is that, you know, figure out where you have leverage at the local level. So in Minnesota, we have it's a monopoly, vertically integrated monopoly utility structure. A city has absolutely zero authority over what their utilities do. But they do have a franchise contract which negotiates the use of public right-of-way to deliver those services that comes up usually every 20 years if we're lucky, and 50 if we're not. And what we did in Minneapolis was that when that contract was coming due, we said to the city, this is your only chance to actually achieve your climate action plan that you have, because the city, the two utilities, gas and electric, are responsible for two-thirds of the emissions in the city, and the rest is transportation, which is already challenging because you've got people who don't live in Minneapolis driving through and whatnot. And so what they did was we got them to talk about, not to actually do, what forming a municipal electric company and a municipal gas company, so they would have that control. And what the utilities came and said was, please don't do that, that's a terrible idea, but we're willing to help you get to your climate action plan. And so we have right now this clean energy partnership that's been formed where the utilities have publicly signed on to help the city meet its climate action plan. But we also have some leverage now. The Public Utilities Commission at the state level is very interested in what we're doing and very supportive in saying, if there are things that you want to experiment and try, come and talk to us about it. We're interested in helping you do stuff to figure this whole thing out, because they would prefer that cities and electric customers work with the utility rather than having to do a New York style figure out the whole new market structure. I think unfortunately they're kicking the can down the road on that one. But I think my point is that grab whatever levers that you have, and there may be more than you think of. But it is going to be a political fight, there's no question about it.
The peak during a short period of the 24-hour, you need either more copper or you need batteries or a combination of the both. And so I imagine that at some point an agent of the people, in the interest of democracy and in the interest of climate mitigation, are going to be presenting results from their model, and the utility will be presenting results from their simulation model of the grid. Do you know of such work that's going on where adversary proceedings are being resolved in this country on the basis of actual simulation models of the distribution grid, similar to the model that's used in the MIT Future of Solar study, similar to adversary proceedings that go on in Europe? Has that started here? And do we have a precedent that we could follow here in Massachusetts?
That's a good question. In terms of the way that we are making our decisions about the policies and kind of the choices between the distribution and the transmission system, we have a couple of things working against us. One is that transmission level planning and distribution level planning have almost never been integrated. So at the transmission level, they, generally speaking, ignore everything that happens at the distribution level. The governance of that is even separate, that usually transmission is governed by regional transmission authorities, and that states are responsible for stuff that happens within their borders. And there is limited overlap, for example, when an interstate transmission line is being proposed, where state service commissions will be responsible for approving their particular section of it, but not for the planning process, and not for the, could we have done anything to provide the same services for less using distributed generation, for example. So that's been an organizational problem. I have a slide I show sometimes in my presentations of, it's an empty boardroom, and it's basically like, and with a quote, hearing no objections, because unfortunately it's both expensive and difficult to go and participate in those transmission level proceedings for a nonprofit organization or a state entity, you're paying your own way against entities that are there in the room because they make money by building transmission lines. So that's one of our problems. The second one would be that although I do think that at this Public Service Commission, one can have a situation in which the truth will win by having good, two models against each other and a real discussion of the objectives, we humans don't make decisions that way. We rationalize on the basis of what's in our gut. And so the real battle is going to be won over this, about changing people's perspective about what the grid should look like, and then the argument that you want to present with numbers is going to be more successful. I mean, there are limits to that, and different people are persuaded more by the amount of numbers they see. But we also face this problem again with, the modeling that the utility companies use with their resource planning in Minnesota, for example, is a proprietary model. So unless you are entitled to trade secret level viewing of their data, you don't know how they're doing that modeling. And they won't tell you. And unless you have a degree in electrical engineering, it's pretty hard to understand how they come up with that. And so we're in a cruddy situation, I guess is what I would say, about our ability to fight data with data, because there is no equity at that point. And that's why I think the organizing from the outside can be a lot more successful. If a public utilities commission feels the legislature breathing down their neck about distribution level planning, they're going to be inclined to ask a lot better questions about the modeling that the utility does. And they're going to be in a better place to ask those questions. So I think it really does come down to this issue of figuring out where are the potential leverage points again in that conversation, and what are the opportunities, like the value of solar. I don't know anything about doing the detailed level modeling in the value of solar. I did help get that legislation passed by simply saying, here's the five things I want you to look at when you do that modeling. Just make sure those words are in the legislation. And so that's the kind of level of conversation that we have to be able to engage in. And where we have to make sure the conversation happens so that we don't get buried at the commission with the utility saying, well, we modeled it and we can't put more than 100 megawatts of distributed generation in our system without this substation blowing up. Because once you get to that point, you've already lost.
Thank you.
I was at a presentation at Harvard earlier this week looking at the effect of retail choice and electricity rates over the last 20 years or so. And the presentation left me with a rather perplexing conclusion, and I wonder if you might be able to help make some sense of it. And that is basically that in the states where there was deregulation and retail competition for electricity rates, i.e. disaggregation of the different roles that the traditionally vertically integrated utilities have played, there was actually less uptake of things like smart grid installation and green power use and distributed generation than in the places with the traditional vertically integrated utilities. And in fact, the prices traditionally were higher in the environments that had retail choice. And so I'm trying to make sense of this, because intuitively it sounds to me that it makes a lot of sense to push the decision making out to the perimeter and allow for the innovation that comes with having greater degrees of freedom within that system, and yet from the presentation that I saw, the data didn't suggest that, and I'm just curious what you might have heard or what you think about that.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. It really gets to the heart of when you structure a market, what are the places where innovation can happen based on that structure. My sense of, and I'm certainly not an expert in this, but my sense of the kind of deregulation is actually not the right word. There's a different one word that people use for what you described, and I can't think of it right now. I apologize. But the
restructuring.
Yeah, restructuring. Thank you.
Yep.
But the restructuring, I think was, it's always been funny to me, because the place where the electricity came was still the same. It was the same power plants that you were buying from. You just weren't owned by the same entity anymore. And so I was struck, for example, last year, the Citizens Utility Board in Illinois was. Which is a consumer advocate around, and they do have retail choice, was saying essentially they've done kind of a report on the history of retail choice and the pricing options, and they said essentially what retail choice had done for consumers in Illinois was to make electricity pricing more like your cable bill, which is to say there were promotions and there were gimmicks, and there was not a whole lot of anything happening that was of sort of public interest in terms of reducing energy demand, pricing energy on a time of use basis, or any of those things that would allow us to get to some of those bigger public goods. And I don't know, like I said, I don't know enough about the rules that were put in place to know whether or not that was because that was not possible, or whether it was simply that it was just not as easy as going out and trying to find cheap wholesale electricity that you could resell to folks, and that promotional pricing and market share were the drivers of that. So it is definitely a good lesson in thinking about how we structure the rules for the new system. And I think that's why, in general, I think we are seeing a positive movement toward performance-based incentives and returns as opposed to capital-based returns. You know, the traditional utility sector was build something and we'll pay you back for it plus a little. And now we're getting toward do something publicly useful like reduce demand or relieve congestion or meet this energy need and we'll pay you for that. And I think that's, to me, that is, I think that the restructuring sort of predated that philosophy of making sure that we were rewarding performance. And so we've had some issues with that. And I also, you know, I've also been a skeptic of it too, as you watch, you know, some of you may or may not be familiar with the Exelon, which is a Midwestern-based utility that owns a whole bunch of nuclear power plants, was recently trying to acquire, or still in the process of trying to acquire Pepco, the distribution utility that serves Washington, D.C. And the reason for that is essentially they want a captive market that they can sell their nuclear power to, because the competitive market didn't work out so well for them. They were big fans of it when they thought that they could make good returns on it, and then when the market really became competitive, hence low marginal returns, they wanted to get back into captive market. The same thing is happening with AEP in Ohio. So I think the lesson from restructuring was it really didn't accomplish the social goods we were hoping for, and that's partly because we didn't put the right rules in place. And that doesn't mean that when we iterate here and we're figuring out what can we do with distributed generation and whatnot, you know, we have to be asking for those things. So, you know, we have to be pricing the things that the grid needs. You know, we do that to some extent already at the wholesale level with demand response, with capacity, voltage control, and those kind of things. At the distribution level, we're going to localize that, you know, behind a particular substation. Where do we need voltage regulation? Where do we need those kind of things? And the good news is we have the technology there. You know, we have smart inverters for PV that can provide that kind of service. But then, of course, there's the trade-off that you take the real power that they sell to the grid, and now you're using it as what's called reactive power. So you make less revenue from that if there's not a revenue stream to provide it. So, again, thinking through the rules that we have in the system, I feel like I can get into weeds there. I don't want to go too much further with that. But it's a great question about the role that retail choice played and the implications for where we're going.
And there's at least one libertarian in the room, so I'm worried I'm going to get beat up for asking this question. But the question that I have is, in some ways, you've alluded to the challenges of making the kinds of markets that will allow for democracy and will produce the goods that this energy democracy and produce the goods that we want, right? So I guess the question for me is, in some ways, might it be a question of incentives for utilities that maybe might be able to do things more quickly or more coherently than a market might, even if the market would do something more efficiently over a longer period of time? You know, people talk about Green Mountain Power, like they love talking about Green Mountain Power, which is, you know, a vertically integrated utility doing really amazing things. And you talked about how, you know, Arizona utilities started building solar when they were allowed to make money off of it. So I guess the question I have is, could an argument be made that we should be providing better incentives for utilities to do some of these things rather than trying to redo the entire market and change the wings on the flying airplane?
Yes, an argument can be made for that. Green Mountain Power is a great example because it is the only electric utility in the entire country that is also a benefit corporation, which is an important distinction, in that it is allowed legally to consider things other than the bottom line for its shareholders in terms of the decision-making process. You know, it's important to keep that in mind with the electric utilities like in Minnesota, for example. Well, I don't think they would see themselves as simply like trying to pump money to shareholders. That is their primary legal responsibility, followed by following the rules of everything else, or, you know, I'm not the lawyer for them, but anyway, it gets a little more complicated. And I think that the issue here is, if you think about the utility system the way that was historically, think of the utility as a juggler, and there's a discrete number of balls that they're juggling, because there's a few large power plants that are providing the power to the system, and there's nothing else really happening on the system that they don't own and control. And now what's happening is I'm the utility, I'm up here juggling, everyone out here has a ball, and you're starting to throw them at me. And they're starting to throw them at me faster and faster. And the question is it rational to assume that one entity could be responsible for all of that? It's just too much to keep track of. And so I think the reason that the market structure not only is appealing from the idea of decentralizing that control, and I'll get back to that in a second, but it's also, I think, the rational course where there's a limited amount of, there's going to be a limited ability to manage all of that kind of stuff that's happening on the system. You're going to need to switch it, even internally within a monopoly structure, to think to a system where the utility simply can't control everything. It's going to have a way to manage that system, understanding that a whole bunch of different players are going to be acting upon a whole bunch of different, for a whole bunch of different reasons, whether it's environmental, you know, motivations or economic motivations or whatever. And I think it will ultimately be a more efficient and better managed system if we are giving people pricing signals to tell them, like, you could put solar on your house, but because we are over capacity in this part of the distribution system, your pricing is going to be bad, versus we have a net metering law that we fought very hard to keep, and I'm damn well going to put it up on my house no matter what you say, and now the utility has to figure out how to manage that power flow back through the substation. So I think it becomes much more clunky to try to manage the grid system in that way than it will be to have a system that is kind of rational from the top down. The second thing I would say about it is that sticking with the monopoly, even if we assume that the monopoly, given the right incentives, can act appropriately, they are still a powerful political entity that we are allowing to exist that has tended to fight the public interest. And is that a wise choice? Or should we move to a system in which no particular actor has that much power to oppose doing the things that we want out of our electricity system? And to me, that's one of the biggest concerns and one of my biggest excitements about what's happening in the system is that if we are seeing them as such monumental roadblocks and that idea of cultural change from monopoly is this challenging, we might just be better off figuring out an alternative. I think there was a question.
Can I just follow up on that?
Sure.
I think we need the concept of a public physical sense because you want one entity only in control of that infrastructure. You don't want to have five lines going down your street because you have five separate utilities. You want one utility. So in the physical sense, it's a monopoly. But to your point, if it was a public monopoly, not driven by the private investment decisions, but by the public, in other words, socializing, it would make a lot more sense. And the other thing that I want to throw into the discussion, you hit on a lot of very important points in your initial presentation, a lot of good metaphors. And I have worked in the utility industry, both in transmission and distribution planning. One thing the public does not understand, and I'm going to use a metaphor or an analogy, which is somebody who owns a home or a landlord who owns an apartment complex. You don't, when you buy that home, when you build that home, when you build a utility system, you don't take a bunch of cash out of your pocket, put it on the table, and say, deal is done. You enter into a contract with a bank, with the residents over a long-term 30-year process. And all of those wires out there are not paid for yet. They're still going to be paid for over many, many years. Now, when you buy a home, you get a mortgage from the bank, you're paying for that home for the next 30 years. If you decide to leave that home, you've got to pay off the bank the unpaid principal that's left on the mortgage. The utilities have equipment that's already been built because of previous demand that required that be built. So even if I leave the grid tomorrow, the line that's outside my street is still going to have to be paid for many more years. And I was responsible for that line being there because of my past behavior, which required that line to be there.
What's the question?
If I leave, then the utility still has to pay for that line.
I'd like to second that. What is your question, sir?
Well, the point is, it's not a question. I said it was a follow-up. My point is that while we have to have fundamental change in the way the whole utility system works and making public monopoly is a way to do it, we also have to understand, where are the utilities coming from? Why are they saying what they're doing? We have to at least understand where they're coming from at the same time that we try to flip the whole world into a different environment. That's my point.
Yeah, so let me offer a brief response to that, which is, I think the perspective that the utilities have offered in this situation is essentially, we have costs, you can't leave us with them. And my question is, going forward, and this should not be a hard question to answer in my opinion, is you have value in that network. Tell us what the value is and how to pay for it. Because we've sort of got it backwards right now, what we're talking about. You know, and in part it's because we don't, it's not very rational for people to want to leave the electric grid. If nothing else, even if you have a whole bunch of solar arrays, it's a great battery, right? And so the question is, how do you appropriately have people pay for that value? And it might not be commensurate with what the cost to put that line up was originally, but you have a whole bunch of different ways you have to recover that cost. And it, you know, this comes out with the whole fixed charges thing, and I think it's sort of, a lot of utilities are saying, well, we have lots of fixed costs and we should have lots of fixed charges. And Carl Robigo, one of my favorite folks on this issue, always talks about, it's like a coffee shop like Starbucks saying it's $10 to come in and you can drink as much as you want. They have a lot of fixed costs. They've got labor costs and equipment costs and rental, property costs and energy costs, but they don't charge you $10 to go in the door. So costs don't equal pricing, but we do have to figure out how to address that. And I think it's in the pricing of the value of those services. And there is going to be a way that we're going to end up paying for that. And I think you're right. Whether or not it's a publicly owned monopoly or not, we are going to have a single entity in control of that distribution system and making those investments. And the question is, what are the principles that we need to have in place to do that? In the back.
It's going to be necessary for energy storage, assuming that that's battery technology that is state of the art in 10 years or whatever. And just curious about other alternatives like pumped hydro and some of those sort of simpler options, what your opinions are about different storage media as we really go from kind of boutique to full-scale operation of this.
Sure. So my first, I have two thoughts about the energy storage. One is that it's so sexy and exciting to talk about right now and all the different technologies, and so it's sort of hard to wrap our minds around exactly what role it's going to play. My favorite example in terms of the technology that I read about was loading rail cars full of gravel and pushing them uphill, and then using regenerative braking like we do on electric vehicles to generate power coming down. So you don't need a lot of space. You probably have some places where you already have rails going uphill. And it's, it's the same thing with pumped hydro, right? What are the resources that we already have, or what are the low-cost things that we could deploy? So there's a lot of opportunities out there. I think where we get a little too carried away with energy storage and the danger in talking about it too much is that in the long run, we're really not going to need a whole lot of it. If we have a really smart grid that allows us to manage and control our demand, then we're really only going to need storage on those marginal periods where either it's been not windy and not sunny for a very long time, or we have we have reached the limits of our ability to manage how our electricity is being consumed at any given point in time. But so much of our load is controllable. I don't notice when the utility is cycling off my air conditioner on those hot days for 15 minutes. The air system in my house is still blowing, it still feels cool and whatnot. They're rotating it among a whole bunch of different households. And we've really only scratched the surface of what we can do with that. And I know there are a bunch of barriers there, from privacy issues to security issues to do I want all of my devices and appliances controlled somehow through the internet. But I do think that is going to be the logical place that we go first. And that, the energy storage is going to be exciting, but I don't know that it's going to have to scale in quite the way that we think it might. And there are a lot of different issues, ones that I certainly don't get into in my work, in terms of, what are the materials and where are we getting them from and all of that kind of thing. But I think we have such a multiplicity of options for energy storage, like the train car thing that I mentioned, but also a lot of untapped opportunity to manage energy demand before we even get to storage.
I was at a legislative hearing last night on virtual net metering in Rhode Island, And the hearing officer for the PUC in Rhode Island that's going to be hearing, that's going to be overseeing the values of solar kind of proceeding, raised the question that, raised the suggestion that net metering shouldn't be expanded because it, or virtual net metering shouldn't be expanded because it runs into FERC jurisdiction and all sorts of FERC objections. And I've heard both sides of that, and I know we're getting into the weeds a little bit, but wondering if you've heard a definitive answer on, you know, FERC objections to off-site generation. And I mean, it seems like with 16 states having community net metering or community solar, if FERC was going to intervene, they would have already done it.
I think, you know, that I've actually never heard of an implication with FERC jurisdiction over virtual net metering. I guess I can sort of understand it in the sense that if I'm 100 miles away from that facility, there's a possibility that were the energy actually traveling to me, it would cross into transmission lines that would be FERC jurisdiction. I mean, net metering is a billing arrangement. That's not kidding anybody, right? The electrons never flow the way they should.
The argument I've heard is because it's electricity for sale, then it gets into FERC. You know, the response is that it's just credit.
Yeah, that's going to be decided by some folks who are lawyer in that realm in a very specific way, I think. I really have, my understanding is that as long as it's been a bill credit relationship, when you do net metering, whether it's on-site or off-site, that it both avoids securities law stuff and tax law stuff and jurisdictional issues around transmission and distribution systems. Because it's really, as long as the utility is willing to participate or required by law to participate, it's really just a matter of figuring out the billing system and not fundamentally changing the way that power is bought and sold. Especially in the way, too, that utilities have traditionally viewed on-site generation as simply load reduction. So in that sense, there's really no sale going on at all. And in fact, that's the way that utilities, if they've modeled at all what's happening at the distribution level with power generation, have modeled it is simply we have less load to serve from up here. So I don't know, I'm not going to say anything more about it because I simply don't have anything more intelligent to say about it.
I have kind of a different question thinking about, I work with students in a renewable energy program of all ages interested in getting involved and contributing to some of these creative solutions. So how professionally, if they wanted to get involved in transforming the grid, this is what they want to do with their career, to be part of this sort of changing the culture of monopoly, what kind of pathway to proceed with the one participating? What kind of background knowledge that they need? I mean, I can see many, whether it's policy, there's engineering, but then sort of pop up and say, you want to get into this, really participate in transforming the grid over the next 10 or 20 years, what would be a good
You know, every time I get a question like this, I always laugh because it sort of implies that I got where I was because of some careful planning. I took one class on energy policy in my master's program, and then I was interviewing, I went out for coffee with 50 different people after graduation over 4 months, basically just asking what's going on in this space and where are places that I could work. And the Institute for Local Self-Reliance was one that came up, and so I called them and just said, you know, hey, I'm interested in learning more about what you guys work on. I wasn't even specifically interested in energy. There's a whole bunch of different work that we do across many different economic sectors. And they said, well, we have a position open. Why don't you just interview for it? Yeah. And so I did, and I got the job. And it's been a lot of on-the-job training. And so I think my lesson from that really is that, you know, it's going to be, first of all, is that for the many years between undergrad and getting this job, not to let your job get in the way of doing what you want to do, and so finding other ways to participate. You know, for me, that was a lot of volunteer work or free internships or whatever else that you can do in your other time. So, you know, get a job doing something that pays the bills and then make sure that you have other ways to follow your interests, you know, or go back to school to do that or what have you. I wish I had better advice than that, but there is such a range of ways that people can get involved, and I think ultimately, when people are passionate about it and they keep exploring the opportunities for it, they're going to find a place to land.
So I want to come back to the issue of stranded costs, which was already raised a little bit. You set a timeline. You said the U.S. should probably not, or states should not allow any new fossil dual-fired plants we built out for 2020. And I'd like to hear a little bit more about how you arrived at that date. We see in California, we're helping run some of the distributed generation incentive programs there. And there is an inherent, as you pointed out, I think very well, there's a political conflict between what the market is now starting to offer and what the utilities are willing to allow to happen. And they're going to continue to resist for some amount of time. They're going to continue to justify investments like the Carlsbad paper plant that they just put in over preferred resources, distributed generation, fuel cell storage, and floating. They're going to continue to resist. At what point do you see, just in terms of the timeline, do you see that conflict breaking one way or the other? Right? When does the market overwhelm the utility of resistance? And when can we expect, realistically, Public Utilities Commission to actually stop building gas-fired plants?
One way I think that is really helpful is that when states set very long-term but very high target goals for renewables, it sends a message that what you're building today may not be operating when we hit that date. And I think that's actually a really important thing, because when we talk about the notion of stranded costs, the implication was that it was a rational, reasonable investment at the time, thus we are on the hook for it. And so the issue, I think right now, the crux of the issue is, to what extent can we make the argument that these investments, should they be made now, are irrational, and therefore, if you want to make it, it is very high risk. And you know, we're going through this in Minnesota right now. The largest investor-owned utility, Xcel, is making plans in their resource plan to retire two units at their largest coal-fired power plant in the next 10 years. And their preferred option right now is to do that largely with gas-fired capacity at the same location. And we've got, fortunately, about three more months in the comment period where we can try to lay out the case that essentially says the state has a goal. It's not a binding goal, but we have a goal for an 80% greenhouse gas reduction by 2050. The utility has also said that it's open to retiring its two nuclear facilities, which are 20% of its carbon-free portfolio. There's almost no chance that it would make sense for them to build any new fossil fuel generation right now or in the next 10 years, because it's probably not going to be able to keep operating beyond that 2050 date. And as soon as you shrink the timeline for repayment, there's almost no chance it's going to be economical compared to a renewable alternative. So that's the kind of way that I see us making this argument, is at the very front end, finding a way to make the case that these, whether or not they're rational or irrational, but simply they're going to be much riskier investments than the utility has said that they are. And because they're higher risk, you can still make them, you know, but you have to be aware that it may be your shareholders that are on the hook for it. It becomes, unfortunately, more complicated because investor-owned utilities represent a lot of our power generation, but not all of it. We also have municipal and rural electric cooperatives, and the problem there is that the shareholders are us, so we get screwed when those decisions are made poorly. Fortunately, we also, generally speaking, in those places, have a more direct sort of legal route for participation, whether it's through municipal elections or whether it's through the cooperative member elections, although we've done an unfortunate amount of research on the lack of democracy at rural co-ops. But I guess what I would say about that is that is the case that we have to make, is that these are risky investments to be making in light of the low-carbon future that we are going toward. And I think that we can successfully make those arguments not just on environmental grounds of the lifetime of this plant based on the carbon pollution is not likely to be very long, but simply that they're high-risk investments, that they're costly, and that, you know, renewables are not going to have any volatility in their fuel prices for their entire lifetime. Yes, the capital costs are expensive up front, but you can't promise me anything about gas prices 20 years from now. I mean, you couldn't even done it 5 years ago. And so I think that's where we have to look into that conversation. Yeah.
The gripe that I hear from National Grid around here is the collision that occurs, the PV starts pumping backwards into the transformers. Are there any technical solutions to that problem, or different style of transformer? I'm not a leader at all, so I'm just wondering if off in the weeds there are any technical solutions that can mitigate that problem and take the spikiness out of National Grid's problem, because they seem really kind of stuck on it, and it creates an attitude of, oh crap, not another one. It really diminishes the receptivity to this approach.
I think it's most useful to have it, and you know, New York has played around with that with some locational-based incentives, where they were looking at paying more for capacity in certain places on the grid. I think that's an important way to approach that. I think the second thing, though, is to simply acknowledge that if we're going to go to a low-carbon system, we're probably going to have a system in which local power generation is going to push back onto the larger grid. And so to simply ask the question, well, how much does it cost? I'm sure there are solutions to that, to be able to manage the power flow back through. I mean, the way I'll keep thinking about this is, you have transformers, which, you know, change the voltage of the electricity from the low to the high. The lines that come in there have the same capacity going in either direction. They're dumb. It's the things that connect them that have the limitations. And so what can we do to mitigate that? You know, can we have energy storage on either side of the substation that would soak up some of that, because it's probably only for a few minutes or hours during the day? Can we have upgrades to that particular facility that allow it to push back onto the transmission system? This is way beyond my pay grade in terms of engineering questions. But the thing is that I feel like if you got a bunch of engineers in the room who are not, whose salaries didn't depend on coming up with the answer being this is hard and expensive, we would probably come up with a lot of very interesting solutions.
Question about grid security. And by the way, it is a power pole, it's a transformer. It's a protected relaying system around the pole. But a question about grid security. A question about grid security. Last week, I think in the Ukraine, hackers shut down the grid, and it was not a major outage. It lasted maybe 4 or 5 hours. But we always think about the vulnerability of a centrally operated planned electric utility system. Are we safe in assuming that a decentralized system such as your invention is going to be more secure from a vulnerability standpoint than what we now have? Or are we fooling ourselves? Does it give hackers an increased opportunity to disrupt things?
I think that's a great question. I don't know that I have a satisfactory answer. We are forging ahead into a brave new era in which we are connecting more and more of the things in our lives to the internet and doing it in a sort of haphazardly secure method. The good news is that, it, generally speaking, in a decentralized system would be more challenging, more difficult than it's worth to go about disabling a whole bunch of systems that are, if you can't do that from a central location. So I guess what I'm saying about it is, it's sort of like the personal fear that people have about being hacked, right? You know, it used to be that they said, well, for your sensitive documents, you should shred them before you recycle them. Well, people don't go diving in dumpsters for documents or anything like that anymore. They get on the internet and they hack something or other. Like with your password, like it's true that having a nice secure password would be a great idea, but your password's only as secure as the people into whose hands you put it. You know, when a retail store gets hacked and they expose your credit card number and the passwords, it's not really down to the individual. So I feel like I'm going on a tangent here. There's a couple different ways to look at this. One is that in a centralized system, there are a few points of operation in the grid which you could physically get to and cause an enormous harm. And so we've always had that vulnerability that we probably have not planned sufficiently for. In a distributed future, we have many, many more points of physical interaction, which would be much more difficult to get to. And yet, I remember it was a year or two ago that one of the solutions that they came up with for the voltage regulation of the distribution system in Hawaii was that they had a whole bunch of smart inverters that were internet connected, and they pushed out a software update to them. And my first thought was, that's really cool, they could do that. And my second thought was, what if that wasn't a software update? And so it is an issue, and we have to figure out how to secure those systems. And I think what we have to be prepared for is, the way we have to design our system is to assume that at some point it is gonna get taken down. So how can we bring it back up again? What will make the system resilient? You know, when we plan for somebody cutting a high voltage transmission cable that could take down the grid, what is the contingency? Well, there's lots of reserve capacity on the system in order to pick that up while that can be repaired. You know, we have to make the same kind of planning. So, you know, is the software designed from the ground up to basically reboot itself after 4 hours of being hacked to just go back to its original state or something like that? I mean, those are things that you can program in. So, I don't know, I think it gets very much into the weeds. I don't know that a decentralized system is inherently, I think there are some inherent advantages and some inherent disadvantages, and we just have to plan adequately for them.
Okay,
So this is a question about the scale. So, you know, we're talking a lot about rooftop solar, but one of the other things that I find needs to, for Local Self-Reliance has done is looking at each state's ability to produce its own energy consumption from renewables. And I guess my question is, what do we do with that information? Right, like, what does it mean that Massachusetts can produce 60% of its own generation from local renewables, or that, you know, Michigan can produce more than 100% from whatever? How do we use that information? What does that mean to you?
What it doesn't mean is that I think each state should be an island. And that's a question that I often get about, you know, and that's why I always end up saying to people, we're the Institute for Local Self-Reliance, not self-sufficiency. but I think the important part about that, in my mind, is taking the conversation beyond the cost per kilowatt hour, which it so often is, and to be able to make the argument and have the conversation about, you know, you could buy on the wholesale market electricity from wind power in Illinois, which is arguably cheaper at the point of generation than wind electricity in Massachusetts because the wind blows better there, or from Minnesota for that matter. Now granted, there's gonna be some cost to having that power sent on transmission lines. There's gonna be some losses and whatnot, and so the cost per kilowatt hour, you know, in Minnesota where it interconnects is gonna be different from when it would reach here. And again, going back to the electrical engineering perspective, if those electrons ever really get here, it's, you know, I find it fascinating the way that the transactional nature of the grid is completely separated from that. But ultimately, there's a lot more to a wind farm or a solar facility than the electricity it produces. There's the jobs that it creates and the people who get those jobs and the economic benefits and the, whether or not those panels were built in the state in which they are being installed, and a whole slew of questions about this. You know, we're going to spend a lot of capital on our electric system. We're already doing that. We always have been doing that. And the question is, as we continue to spend money on that infrastructure, how much of that do we want to capture locally? And does it matter? And it really, I mean, it creates a tension because we're kind of a society that has looked at this as sort of like a free trade kind of thing. Like, who cares where it comes from? Because it's really just about the price. And yet, at the same time, we do need to think about that because it's actually what matters to our communities. You know, it's, my colleague works, for example, on independent businesses. She's done exhaustive research on the amount of dollar that stays in a local community when you shop at an independent business instead of a chain store. And not only that, the kind of political and community infrastructure that builds when you have lots of entrepreneurs and owners rather than a whole bunch of retail salespeople and a couple of managers that may have been imported from another state. And so those are the kinds of things that is why we compile that, not to say that a state should generate 66% of its electricity in-house, if you will, but to say that when we are asking the question about how we should envision building our energy system, what are the implications beyond energy production that we need to be considering?
I heard a number of comments and questions around public participation in the political process, and I guess this is perhaps more a comment, maybe, or a point of discussion than a question, but I work with public policy in Massachusetts, and wanted to just sort of stress the importance of public comment in all of the processes. And because I think that whether it's through your organization or your company providing input professionally, or whether it's you sitting at home typing out an email to your state legislator to provide input to a particular process, I think that it's very important. And before I started working very intensely in policy, I never understood the importance of that public comment process. And so I just would encourage people to become very active in that.
Good anecdote for that is in Florida, the investor-owned utility companies have one lobbyist for every two legislators. The legislators are hearing a lot from them. And so the only way to have countering on political power is to have legislators hearing from other people who have a different perspective. Yeah.
Could you talk a little bit more about what you mean by independent local grid managers and how that differs from an ISO, a regional manager of generation and distribution transmission?
It may not differ a lot from that. To be honest, I follow a lot of what John Wellinghoff and James Tong have written about this. They put together a number of pieces. They did a great report for what the Solar Electric Power Association was calling the 51st State Project. It was kind of like, we started from scratch, how would you design the power system? They also have kind of a set of five principles, one of which they're talking about a lot is what's called grid neutrality. I think they really are looking at a system that would be very similar. Kind of the question, the question in my mind right now is, if you operate it just like an ISO, kind of at the wholesale level, and you bring it down to the distribution level, who owns that system? And are they also allowed to participate in that market in other ways? And that's kind of the thing that New York is wrestling with is, okay, so we sort of demote the utility to a distribution manager in some ways, but are we also going to allow them to produce their own power on that system and to buy it from themselves, essentially? And that's the stuff that always makes me a little squeamish is, you know, when we talk about this issue of, you know, sort of changing from a monopoly to something else, we could have a public monopoly, and the nice thing about that is that the public monopoly is generally not competing with the private participants in that marketplace. So I don't know that I can go into a whole lot more detail about what that system is like. I mean, I envision it being a system in which the responsibility is largely around deploying the infrastructure that is demanded by the market and doing kind of some planning and forecasting that helps lead to the development of the right rules by a different entity for how that system should be appropriately designed and run. So really more of an implementer and kind of a day-to-day manager. But I think that's the best idea.
We got to
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'm told we have to wrap up. Thank you so much.